Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
The book of Revelation teaches clearly that just before the end of the world, there is going to be a testing time for all the world in which everybody in the world is going to be marked. When Jesus comes, everybody in the world that is alive will be marked. They will either be marked with the seal of God or with the mark of the beast. And one mark will ensure, guarantee, that you will have eternal life and that you will be in heaven. The other mark will ensure, it will guarantee, that you will be destroyed and have eternal death. And every person in the world will have made it public what mark he has. Now, before we get into studying not just the Bible, but Spirit of Prophecy references on this subject, I would like to review with you the fact that you know from studying your Bible that in all ages, God has tested his children. Now, there's going to be a great final test, but God has tested his people in every age of the world, and there's many mentions of this fact in the book of Genesis. And let's look at an example of how God tests his children in the book of Genesis. If you look in Genesis chapter 22, it says, "Now it came to pass, after these things, that God tested Abraham." God tested Abraham. There are some translations that say that God tempted Abraham. Actually, that is not the best translation of the Hebrew word. James 1:13 tells us that God doesn't ever tempt anybody. God tests people, but he does not tempt them. Only the devil tempts. Let me explain the difference. The devil tests people, but the devil tests you hoping that you will fail a test. That's a temptation. He's trying to bring you down. God tests people, but God arranges things so that he never allows a test. God never allows a test to come to you that it is impossible for you to overcome, impossible for you to succeed. Now, if God didn't do this, friends, we would all fail. God could allow tests to come to each one of us that we could not stand, we could not endure, and we would all fail the test. But Ellen White says that before God allows any test to come to any human being, he evaluates it first. Is this person able to withstand this kind of a temptation? God doesn't allow the temptation to come to you, except arrangements have been made before it ever happens. You remember it says in 1 Corinthians 10:13 that there is no temptation that has taken you except what is common to mankind. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted above what you're able to bear, but will with the temptation make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. That's 1 Corinthians 10:13. So that text shows us that before God allows a temptation or trial to come to you, he evaluates you and the temptation to see, is this person going to be able to succeed? Will they be able to endure this temptation? God, it says, tested Abraham. Now, perhaps it is well that I did not get this far in what we were studying this morning, because I'm going to tell you something now that's really hard. And maybe a baby Christian couldn't endure this, but it's very true. And that is this. You and I are actually determining our own judgment day by day, our own tests. Now, we don't really think of that very often, but it's true. We are determining day by day the tests that God is going to have to bring upon us in order for us to be saved. Let's just go back to Abraham. Why did Abraham have to have this test? Ellen White's very, very clear in a number of places why this had to be. Abraham would not have had to have this test because God had already given him another test. And if he had passed the other test previous to this, this test never would have been given. Ellen White's very clear about that. Now, the other test that God gave to Abraham, God promised Abraham when Abraham was 75 years old and Sarah was 65 years old. Now remember, a lot of people lived way over between 1 and 200 years in those days, so that's not the same as a 75 and 65-year-old person today. But God promised Abraham that he would give him a son. But it didn't happen right away. And Abraham got to be 80. Sarah was 70. Abraham got to be 85. Sarah got to be 75. Abraham got to be 86. Sarah was 76. Sarah went through menopause. The Bible's very clear about that. And so Sarah said, there's no way that I'm going to be able to have a child now. And so Sarah went to Abraham and said, now by the way, the reason she did that was because it was happening all over in those days. That was customary. In fact, the archaeologists have dug up reports that they put it right in the marriage covenants in those days. That if the wife could not have children, she could get for her husband, and often was required to get for her husband, a secondary wife so that she could have children, so that they would preserve their family name. And so this was happening all around. It was not happening all around hundreds of years later in Moses' time, and you now not hear any record of anybody in the Bible ever doing anything like this. But in Abraham's time and in Jacob's time, this was happening all around the country. And so they were susceptible to what was going on in the world around them, just like people today are susceptible to what's going on in the world around them. And Sarah told Abraham, she says, we need to get you a secondary wife so that I can have children by her. I can't have children anymore myself. And so Sarah convinced Abraham. He got into an adulterous marriage. That marriage was adultery. All polygamy is adultery, period. There are no exceptions. But polygamy had become so common, Ellen White says, that they had ceased to think that it was a sin. Now, this is something that you can look around in our own society. If everybody or most of the people in our society are doing something, eventually people don't think it's wrong anymore. Are there things that almost everybody in our society is doing that's wrong? See, whether it's right or wrong has nothing to do with how many people are doing it. But when Abraham married Hagar and got into that adulterous marriage to try to help God out, see, God was giving him a test. Maybe Abraham didn't realize the extent of the test. You suppose, is God ever giving you a test and you don't really comprehend all of what's going on? You suppose that ever happens? And Abraham, by doing that, failed the test that God was giving him. He failed the test. Now, if God gives to you or to me a test, and I fail the test, what does God have to do? God has to bring me around, give me another test. And Ellen White says, every time we come around, the test is more severe. And this test that was brought upon Abraham because of his adulterous marriage to Hagar, that's why this test had to be given. Ellen White says, it was the closest test that has ever been given to a human being. She said, nobody but God could understand the extent of this test upon Abraham. And that test was when Abraham was 120 years old. So Abraham, by his own life, was passing judgment on himself and working things out so that God would have to bring a test on him. Let us just think that through a little bit. When you first get a hold of what we're talking about, it's one of the most scary things in the world. Because the way we live, we're passing judgment on ourselves and making tests for ourselves in the future. Let's read something about that in the Bible. Look in the book of Matthew. Now, this is an interesting fact about the judgment. Matthew 7, 1 and 2. It says, judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the same measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Now, when I first got a hold of that principle, I'd memorized the whole chapter. But the principle didn't sink in. When I first started to really understand what that's talking about, the way I judge you. Now, we all judge other people. Don't think that nobody judges. Everybody judges other people. Now, we're not to judge their heart and character, but we do judge words and actions, and we all do that. But the way that I judge another person is the way that God is going to judge me. And when I first got a hold of that, it was one of the most terrifying things that I have ever learned. Because I realized that I had not always passed the most charitable judgment on other people's words and actions. Now you can decide whether maybe you've never been guilty of that. And I thought, I have not always had the most charitable judgment on other people's words and actions. That means that God is going to judge me in that way. That means that I have created tests for myself that maybe I wouldn't have had to have in the judgment. Let's read another text that has to do with the very same principle. In the book of James, the second chapter, James 2, verse 13. It says, "Judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy." So when I make a decision, make a judgment about somebody else, and my judgment is without mercy, what's going to happen to me? Now, by the way, I'm not even talking about the last judgment. I'm talking about this life. What's going to happen to me? I am going to be judged without mercy. If people could get a hold of this, they wouldn't do a lot of the things that they do. Now, friends, I've lived long enough. I've already had some experience in this. I've already seen. The Lord's brought me over some ground, and I said, yes, I'm going through this because I did that. I was in that kind of a situation back there. If you're over 40, you might be old enough to have had some similar experiences yourself. You had tests or trials that have come upon you that if you hadn't done certain things in the past, you wouldn't have had to go through those things. Another example in the book of Genesis is Jacob. Now, Jacob, if you look in Genesis 32, he had to go through a great night of trial and suffering. He actually wrestled with the Lord all night. And that's called by Jeremiah the time of Jacob's trouble. It's a type of the trouble that the saints of God will go through just before Jesus comes. Why did Jacob have to go through that? Would Jacob have had to go through that if he had never lied to his father? Would he? No, he wouldn't have. That test, the awfulness of that test was a result of what Jacob had done in the past. Jesus says, as you judge, you will be judged. If you judge without mercy somebody else, the time's coming. Right in this life, you will be judged without mercy by somebody else. And so, that being the case, let me ask you this question. Is the time of trouble going to be more difficult, a more difficult test for some people than others? It most certainly is. For several reasons. The time of trouble will be much worse for some people than others. And if you read the chapter on the time of trouble in the book Great Controversy, she brings this out with crystal clarity. In fact, I think I have a statement on that from the Great Controversy right here. Satan will, if possible, prevent them from obtaining a preparation to stand in that day. That's the time of trouble. He will so arrange affairs as to hedge up their way, entangle them with earthly treasures, cause them to carry a heavy, wearisome burden, that their hearts may be overcharged with the cares of this life, and the day of trial may come upon them as a thief. She's talking about the lessons of faith that a person has to learn and know to be able to go through the time of trouble. If I have learned the lessons of faith, the time of trouble won't be nearly as difficult for me as the person that has not learned those lessons of faith. So, the judgment that I make about other people is the judgment that will be made about me. I have many experiences in life where I watch what's happening and I say to myself, if we all believe that as we judge, we are going to be judged, would we be doing what we're doing? The judgment, the kind of judgment that I make about others is the kind of judgment that God will make with me. And what is the issue in the final testing time? Well, the issue is character. There are many people who are Seventh-day Adventists right now that when the final test comes, they're going to change. Here's the way Ellen White described it. And this is a letter that she wrote in 1883. If you had the set of books on selected messages, it's in volume 3, page 415. She says, many are holding the truth only with the tips of their fingers. They have had great light and many privileges. Like Capernaum, they have been exalted to heaven in this respect. In the time of test and trial that is approaching, they will become apostates unless they put away their pride and self-confidence, unless they have an entire transformation of character. Character is the issue. Has my character been transformed so that I have a Christ-like character or not? If I don't have a Christ-like character, the time of test will result in me becoming an apostate. Now, apostate, of course, is a person who falls away from the truth, isn't faithful to the truth. If I have pride and self-confidence and I have not been transformed in character, I will become an apostate. I know of people, Seventh-day Adventists, who have said, well, I won't be deceived because I understand the doctrines. I understand how Christ is going to come. I won't be deceived by all the proclamations about the rapture. I understand the state of the dead. I won't be deceived. I know about what the law of God is. And when I hear people talking like that, it scares me. Not because I believe that they don't know. But Peter knew too. Peter knew the truth. But he had not been transformed in character, so he denied his Lord. Now, let's be very plain in our talk so that when we talk about the testing time, what is the specific test that will be? We know from reading the three angels' messages. If you just read the third angel's message in Revelation 14, 9 to 12, you could conclude immediately that the test is over the law of God, because there's two groups of people described. The first group in verses 9 to 11, those that receive the mark of the beast and worship his image. And then a second group called the saints who keep the commandments. And so the people that keep the commandments are contrasted in the third angel's message with those that receive the mark of the beast. So you could conclude right away, if it was the first time you read it, you could conclude that there's something about the law of God that distinguishes the two groups, because the saints of God keep the law of God. But in Daniel 7, of course, it's specified what part of the law is going to be the special part under attack. It's the part having to do with time, as you read in Daniel 7, 25. Let me read it to you in really simple language, the way Ellen White explains it. This is from a letter that she wrote in 1900. It's in volume 7 of the Bible Commentary, page 980. She says, when the test comes, it will be clearly shown what the mark of the beast is. It is the keeping of Sunday. Those who, after having heard the truth, continue to regard this day as holy, bear the signature of the man of sin, who thought to change times and laws. So we know what the test is. We know what the final test will be. It will be over the law of God, and it will be over specifically the Sabbath Sunday issue. And the time is going to come at, there's going to be a whole series of Sunday laws, just like there was in the 4th century. We usually refer to the Sunday law that was made in 321 by Constantine, but that was just the first Sunday law. They made many, many more Sunday laws. And as they kept, the reason they kept making Sunday laws was because the first one didn't work. When people didn't go to work, they still didn't go to church. They went to the circus. So they made a law a few years later that the circuses had to all close down. So then you couldn't go to the circus. Well, when the people didn't go to the circus on Sunday, they still didn't go to church. They just stayed around the house and did various things. So finally, they made a law that you had to go to church on Sunday. They were going to make you be good. And it's going to be something like that again. There will be a whole series of Sunday laws, one following another. They will get more and more strict until finally. Ellen White says that when these things become universal, God will reveal himself. But she says that there is coming a time. They won't just require you to keep Sunday, but you will be required by law to break the Sabbath. And when that happens, when God's people are accounted criminals for keeping the Sabbath, God is going to intervene. Now, of course, it won't look like it at first, but it will happen. He will walk through the land spreading destruction everywhere. Now, the way our characters are being developed day by day now will determine what we are going to do then. So, Ellen White has a lot to say about the trials we go through now and how they have an effect on our passing the time of test later. She says, now is the time when the members of every believing family must close their lips against speaking words of accusation concerning their brethren. Let them speak words that impart courage and strengthen the faith, which works by love and purifies the soul. Well, somebody says, tomorrow, Pastor Nunez and I are going to Atlanta, Georgia. We're going to be dealing with this issue. We have a lot of situations where different brethren are accusing one another of different things. And people say, well, what I'm saying is true. Do you know, friends, that that isn't even the issue? Whether it's true or not. Now, that is an issue, whether what I'm saying is true or not. But that is not the issue. The issue is we have to learn how to resolve the problems we have in a different way. In this world, the only way any kind of a problem seems to be resolved, whether you're talking about churches or institutions or politics or whatever, the only way a problem seems to be solved is by people having a fight. So, of course, you can go to court and fight it out in court. Of course, Christians are forbidden to do that. But Christians are still tempted to accuse one another, to deal with their problems by accusing one another. Ellen White wrote in the, this is to the youth, in Youth Instructor, in 1893, May 18, she said, we are living in perilous times, and as we draw near the close of Earth's history, there will be no safety for those who do not become familiar with the Word of God. I would warn the disciples of Christ of the impending days of peril, and beseech you to prepare for the time of test and trial. For everything that can be shaken will be shaken. Do we now obey the word of God and live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God? Are we established and settled in the present truth? There is need of closely examining yourselves whether you are in the love of God, for except Christ be in you, you are reprobates. Self-deception is dangerous, and no one of us can afford to go on in delusion. There are several things in that paragraph that Ellen White emphasizes over and over again concerning people who are headed into this final time of test. One, she stated over and over again that we're going to have to be careful students of the Bible. Let's spend just a minute on that. Can a person be a careful student, a diligent student of the Bible? Can they have their mind fortified with Bible truth if they don't ever have time to study the Bible? No, they can't. And there are many, many Christians that do not have very much time to study the Bible because they're busy. Now, they're not criminals. They're busy doing good things. But if I allow myself to get so busy even doing the Lord's work, now I should tell you, this is a temptation for preachers just as well as other people. Preachers can get so busy doing the Lord's work. I heard one preacher say, you get so busy doing the Lord's work that you don't have any time for the Lord. Well, is that serious? That's very, very serious. So whether you're a preacher, teacher, whatever kind of work that you're doing, you can get so busy working for the Lord that you don't have any time to spend with the Lord. And if that's the case, then you're getting ready to head into a testing time that you won't be prepared for. So Ellen White emphasizes over and over again that we need to be diligent students of the Bible. I need to look over my schedule. Now, when I was a young man, I looked over my schedule, and I did not like to get up early in the morning. I liked to get up as late in the morning as I could and still get done what I needed to get done. And so I arranged in my schedule that I was going to have my devotions in the evening, which I did for a number of years. But then there came a time when life got so busy, I couldn't depend on having the time that I wanted in the evening. It seemed like the phone would just ring off the hook. Well, what do you do then? Well, you have to either find time in the morning. Now, Daniel took time three times a day, morning, in the middle of the day, and the evening. We have to take time to study God's Word because if we don't, we won't make it. Even if we go to church every week, it's like with eating. You wouldn't sustain health and life if you just ate once a week. It's the same with your Bible study. We need to be studying the Bible every day. And then she says that, prepare for the time of test and trial, for everything that can be shaken will be shaken. Do we now obey the word of God and live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God? People send me things to study because they think that I'm not teaching or preaching or living something right, and so they send me things to study. I read lots of things that people have written about Bible prophecy and different doctrines and teachings. And I have to examine these things because I have to ask myself the question, am I really living by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God? And if I'm not, well, then something needs to change so that I am. Everything that can be shaken will be shaken. Now, I want to explain that statement for anyone that has never studied it and doesn't understand. That's a quotation, by the way, directly from Hebrews, the 12th chapter, the last part of Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Everything that can be shaken will be shaken. People are confused about that because they think that that means, people think that that's talking about people that leave the church. So whatever church you go to, if you quit going to that church, then people assume you have been shaken out. That's the way people interpret that text. But that's just a final consequence if you begin living an irreligious life. Before that ever happened, something else happened in your life that was the real shaking. And what was that? The real shaking is when you are shaken out from the truth. Now, I know a number of people that used to be Seventh-day Adventists that aren't Seventh-day Adventists anymore. So they don't go to any Adventist church. Well, people say they're shaken out because they don't go to an Adventist church. That is not the reason that they're shaken out, because they don't go to some church. What shook them out was they lost confidence in the truth. Do you know what you believe? Are you? The Bible talks about this. Look what Paul said about it in Ephesians 4. Well, first let's read Ephesians 3. In Ephesians 3, in verse 17, he says that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ. He talks here in verse 17 about being rooted and grounded. All right, you know what that means. That's the language you apply to a tree that's rooted and grounded. You can't pull it up anymore. You can't shake it out. You can't dislodge it. Now look what it says in chapter 4. It says, starting in verse 13, till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, in the cunning craftiness by which they lie in wait to deceive. Now let me ask you a question for you to think through. According to this verse that we just read, that's verses 13 and 14 in Ephesians 4, a time is coming when all the church is going to come into the unity of the faith, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Do you see that in the verse? The time is coming when all the church is going to come into the unity of the faith and arrive at the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Now, how is that going to happen? Now, the ecumenical movement thinks that they know how it's going to happen. They have a plan to get the whole world into one church. We have a different understanding of how that's going to happen on the basis of Bible prophecy. The way we believe that's going to happen is the shaking is eventually going to shake out everybody that doesn't reach this condition. They'll be shaken out. And so, please don't misunderstand. I'm not saying that I or any group of men or any church is going to shake anybody out. This shaking is something that the Lord's going to do. And if I don't come into the unity of the faith, the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, the time will come when I will be shaken out. The Lord will arrange that. So, that gives me something else to think about in regard to the testing time. Is my character being developed in the way that it should, so that I'm ready for the testing time? Now, Ellen White said over and over and over again that everybody is going to be tested. So that includes me, but that includes also you. She said this many different times. Let me just read one or two sentences where she says this. Here's one from Sanctified Life, page 12. She said, the testing time will come to all when the hopes of many who have for years thought themselves secure will be seen to be without foundation. And here's another one. This is from the Review and Herald, 1892, June 7. She said, "The Lord designs that every soul shall be tried in order that it may be apparent who have a living connection with Him. To every believer, the testing time will come. And when it comes to the soul, how the angels of heaven watch to see what shall be the result of the trial." So, how many people are going to be tested? Everybody. Me, you, everybody in my family, everybody in your family. Now, let me ask you this question. And you might think of this as a trick question. I'm not trying to trick you. But I just want to ask, do you have any idea where you will be when you're tested? Now, when I was a child and a young man, I've studied these prophecies for 50 years. My parents taught me a lot of these things when I was still in school. And when you read Bible prophecy, just like the Jews before the time of Christ, you imagine in your mind how you'll be tested. And so in my imagination, I thought, well, in fact, we used to be told this. I can remember back in the Upper Columbia Camp Meeting back in, say, 1951 or back in there. And we were told in the children's meetings how we would be tested. And they said, well, you might now... They told us one time about this great big church of a certain church organization that you know about, and they build huge churches all over the world. And they were telling us how in this church they found this huge cavern. They said, you know, someday you might be down in the bottom of that huge cavern, some dungeon down there. And so in my mind, when I was a child or a young person, I thought, well, the test will be when I have to go to a court and testify to my faith, and there will be people that are called into courts, and then they'll put me in some prison or some dungeon somewhere, and that's what I thought in my mind would be the test. But so often, the test is in a completely different place than we imagined. Now, I'm going to read to you from the writings of Ellen White where many of us are going to be tested. Some of you will be surprised where this is, where we're going to be tested. Here it is. We are living in the testing time. God is proving His people to see who are worthy of admittance into His family. He desires His followers to carry out the instruction contained in the 17th chapter of John. The practice of this instruction is to begin in the home. God measures, you could translate that, God tests. God measures church members by what they are in the home. When Christ's words are obeyed in the home, the influence extends to the church. So where are people tested? Do you have to wait till you go to court or maybe cast into a dungeon or prison to be tested? No. You're getting tested at home. God tests people at home. And they don't even know they're being tested. But they are. The angels are watching. Well, what are they watching? She says, God is proving His people to see who are worthy of admittance into His family. That's the family in heaven. He desires His followers to carry out the instruction contained in the 17th chapter of John. How do the angels determine whether I am carrying out the instruction in the 17th chapter of John? Now, you know what that's about. It's about unity among all of Christ's followers. They're to be one, just as Christ and the Father are one. How do the angels determine? How does God determine, is that happening in my life? Well, God looks, the angels look, at the way I conduct myself at home and the way that I speak to people in my home. That's my testing ground. And we don't even think about being tested, but we're being tested. How do I speak to people at home? How do I act toward other people in my home?
And then she goes on to say, the way that I act, the way I conduct myself at home, is going to carry over and have an influence where? In the church. Did you hear that? She said, when Christ's words are obeyed in the home, the influence extends to the church. So, where's the test? You're tested at home by everyday occurrences that happen in your family. Do you speak kindly to people in your home? Do you not try to force other people to do what you want them to do? Do you refrain from getting angry at people who have made a mistake? How do you deal with all these annoyances? Do you know every human being has annoyances at home? There's nobody that doesn't have any annoyances. All human beings have annoyances, and a large number of the annoyances that we deal with are annoyances at home. And those are tests, and we're not even thinking about it. And all heaven is watching. How am I conducting myself at home? How do I speak? How do I act toward other people in my home? That's where I'm getting tested. And remember, God wants to find out if I am worthy to be taken to heaven. Because if I would ruin heaven, by the way, I talk to people and act toward other people in my home, well, then the Lord's not going to take me. Heaven was already ruined once, and God is not going to have it ruined again. It was ruined so bad that approximately a third of the inhabitants had to be cast out. That's how bad it was. God's not going to let that happen again. And so, we're on test. We're on test and trial to see, are you going to be able to be taken to heaven or not? Or if you were taken to heaven, it's very interesting the way Ellen White describes this in her writing. She wrote to many different, we read the testimonies in worship at Steps to Life. And over again, we've read in different testimonies where she has written to families and she has said, if your family was taken to heaven right now, it would mar all of heaven. Well, is the Lord going to take them? No, the Lord's not going to take them unless there's a transformation of character. Well, friend, the question that I'm asking myself, is my character being transformed? Or am I judging other people without mercy? Remember, if I judge other people without mercy, how's the Lord going to judge me? The Lord's going to judge me without mercy too. That's what the Bible says. Jesus says, as you judge, so will you be judged. The way I judge others is the way I'm going to be judged, period. There's no exceptions. Is my character being transformed? Here's a statement Ellen White wrote about this. If you want to, the reference I have is the Paulson Collection, page 390, 389 and 390 and 391. I do not know if this is in any other work or not. I'm not sure. Ellen White wrote this. She's talking about the testing time. And she says, what great need there is of cultivating tenderness and gentleness. Let's stop there just a moment. Do the angels manifest tenderness and gentleness to each other in heaven? Or do you think that there's any that are rough and crude and hard? Well, if you and I are going to someday go and live among the angels, that's God's plan. It's God's plan for the redeemed to take up the position of the angels that were lost. If we live among the angels, if we take the place of the devil and his angels that were cast out, we have to be fit so that we can live in an angelic society. But if I am not cultivating any tenderness or gentleness in the way that I deal with other people, well, then I'm not getting ready to go. She said, none should be ashamed to manifest a tender, compassionate spirit for those who err, for those who think they make no mistakes, are far from being without fault before God. No one needs to think that the manifestation of compassion is something for which they need be ashamed. Thorough and decided reformation must be made that this hard, iron-like spirit, which has been so often and easily brought to the front and made manifest in words and measures that savor more of the attributes of Satan than of the Spirit of Christ, should be overcome. Now, I'm sorry to tell you, friends, when I read these things, when I was a young man, my mother used to get on my case and tell me point blank that I was just too hard-hearted. And so I had to take that to heart and say, Lord, help me to change. I want to have a different character than I have. I don't want to be judging other people without mercy, so I end up getting judged without mercy, because that's exactly what will happen. The Bible says so. And I had to go to the Lord and say, Lord, I need to be changed. I need to be talking to people and treating people different than I am doing. One time a pastor came to visit our house. I was just, I don't know, a teenager. After the pastor left, my mother said, you were just plain rude to your own pastor. I said, I didn't say anything. She said, that's the trouble. Too hard. She was writing this to people that were working in institutions like Steps to Life, people that were working as ministers, and this is what she said. I have a message for the workers in both high and low position in the office, to each one of them in their several departments. It is that, this is the message she had for them. It is that unless the transforming grace of Christ conforms you to His character, you will never be numbered with the family of God in heaven. Now is the testing time. Angels of God are watching the development of character. My friend, all of us, whatever age you are, doesn't matter whether you're 80 or 10 or 5, whatever your age, you are, as you go through life, you are constantly developing character. What kind of character are you developing? Now, I'm not trying to needle you. I want you to ask this question to yourself. This is not the question for you to ask yourself. I'm not trying to ask you to, I don't want you to give me any answer. This is for you to talk to the Lord about. But as we go through life, every one of us, we are developing a character. And the character that we develop determines whether we pass the test, so that we can be admitted into heaven. She says to these workers, she said, unless the transforming grace of Christ conforms you to His character, you will never be numbered with the family of God in heaven. Now is the testing time. Angels of God are watching the development of character. Your guardian angel is watching your development of character. My guardian angel is watching my development of character. And it's all written down in books. God could show you, He could show it to any of us tonight if He chose to, an exact, perfect description, representation of what our character is. Now, if God were to show you or to me tonight an exact picture, and God could do this. He could do it anytime you want to. He's going to do it to everybody at the end. If He showed you tonight an exact representation, an exact picture of your character, what would you see? Would you be pleased? Or would you say, Lord, I want a different picture. I want a different character. I want to be a different person. Well, friend, if we're going to be that different person, it's going to have to be during the hours of probation. If you're going to develop the kind of character that will be admitted into heaven, that's not going to happen after Jesus comes. That's going to happen before probation closes. And she said to these workers,
Now, I'm not saying that this applies to you, but it did apply to these workers that she was writing to. She said to them, she said, unless you are completely transformed, in other words, changed in character, you're not going to be in the kingdom of heaven. And she says, now is your testing time, and the angels are watching to see what kind of character you're developing. And they're writing it down, and God has an exact record. He could show you and me an exact picture tonight of our character. When you start to think about this, you say, Lord, I want your Holy Spirit to work in my mind a miracle. Well, I need a miracle. Do you need a miracle? Are you talking to the Lord about this every day? Are you saying, Lord, I want your Holy Spirit to transform me in character? The Holy Spirit is the regenerative agent in the plan of redemption that changes people's characters, that changes their hearts as we cooperate. The Spirit of Prophecy is very clear about this. She says point blank in the book Desire of Age that it is through the Holy Spirit that the heart is made pure. You need a pure heart? Well, if you do, you need the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit will give you a new heart, new spirit. That's why it's called a new birth. It's a new creation, Paul says. There's going to be a people. When Jesus comes, the Bible says there's going to be a people that are just like him. There are going to be people that have a perfect character, just like Christ. Now, when I was young, I did not have, even though I was a Seventh-day Adventist, I did not have a perfect conception of this. I thought that, well, the 144,000, they need to have a perfect character, but if you die before that time, you just better have your sins confessed. That's what I thought. But praise the Lord, I have the privilege for the last many years of, in addition to reading my Bible, where the Bible has plenty to say about this, I should have been able to figure it out from the Bible alone. But in addition to the Bible, I have the Spirit of Prophecy. Now, I started reading, and the first time it really hit me hard was when I was about 19 years old, and I was reading in the book Great Controversy, and she talked about, in heaven, about all the people with a perfect character. And I thought, dear, oh dear, where are the people that don't have a perfect character? Well, as I kept studying, I found out about the people that don't have a perfect... They're not there. They're not there. And so, in recent years, in fact, I've been doing it just in the last few months. I've been reading in the book This Day with God. And just that book is enough. I found a whole bunch of places just in that one book where she says everybody that is saved will have a perfect character. She says it in different kind of language, different places. She says it over and over again. Now, when you talk about this, there's always some people say, oh, you're a legalist, you're this, you're that. That's impossible. Listen, friend. Does God ever say that he's going to do something and not be able to do it? If God says that he's going to prepare a people for the coming of the Lord and they're going to have a perfect character, is he going to be able to do that? Not only is he going to be able to do it, he can do it with the weakest or the most sinful. He's done it that way many, many times in the past. When Jesus was here, the people that they thought were the worst sinners ended up being the saved, and the people that everybody thought were the most holy, they ended up being lost. Just read your Bible. The people they thought were the most holy and the most guiltless and the most religious were the Pharisees. They ended up being lost, almost all of them. The tax collectors and a bunch of Roman centurions and a bunch of officials in the Roman government and a bunch of prostitutes, they accepted Jesus as the Savior of the world, and they were saved. And so if God could bring those people, if he could bring the people that were the worst sinners to moral perfection and take them to heaven, what can he do for you? He can do the same for you. And that's when I began to be encouraged, when I realized that God can take somebody that's clear in the bottom of the pit of sin, that's weak and sinful, and everything's wrong with them. And if they surrender themselves to the Lord can transform them so that they have a perfect character. And I said, well, okay, if you can do it for anybody, well, then I believe you can do it for me. And he can do it for you. But remember, friends, we're in the testing time.
And the experiences that we're going through are not just experiences. They're providences that are tests. They're where we're developing our character one way or the other and showing to the whole universe where we are going to end up. We're showing the whole universe that day by day as we go through life. Let's pray and ask the Lord to help each one of us to develop a perfect character. Father in heaven, if there's anyone here who is discouraged or frightened by what we have studied, I pray that you will show that person through your Holy Spirit that with you all things are possible and that there is nothing that is impossible, and that if we believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And Lord, we choose to believe. We choose to believe that through your Holy Spirit you can transform each one of us in character so that we don't ever act like the devil anymore. And so that we don't have any satanic character traits left in our minds, no satanic character traits of feelings or conduct or words. We pray that you will work this great transformation out in us. And Lord, anything that we need to confess, anything that we need to make right so that you can do in us what you want to do, we pray that you'll help us to do our part so that you can work a miracle inside. And we earnestly pray for each member of the church, for each one that comes to this church, that they may receive this miracle, that they may have a miracle of grace that will transform them in character, that we may become Christ-like in our thoughts, our feelings, our words to others, our judgments concerning others, and every detail of our life. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.